Thank you very much. So for the opportunity. So indeed, I'm have similar model with Manfred, but we have some question of how to get further particles like the leptons and we disagree here. So Manfred's model can be seen as that topological charge is this kind of Hedgehog configuration. So what I'm saying that there is additionally this distinguishing. So the second and third axes are different. So the difference is that we get this rotation of Manfred's axis is now recognized. So no longer this kind of field but by this kind of field. And what is the motivation? So one motivation is that we have three types of hedgehog. We have electron-like hedgehog, also the second hedgehog, I call it muon-like hedgehog, and the tauon hedgehog. So we can perform the hedgehog with one of three distinguishable axes. So they have the same topological charge, which will work as electric charge as in Manfred model, but have different energy, different types of tension of the field. So they have three different. So we have the same charge, electric charge, but different masses. So and this is one argument to get the three types of leptons. So we don't have just single charge, but also the other two leptons. Also, there appears this rotation, this rotation which was not there in Manfred model. So in Manfred model, this rotation vanishes because there is no rotation. So I'm saying so adding this rotation will work as quantum phase. So for example, for this kind of configuration, we'll get a Klein-Gödel-like equation for this additional phase of the rotation. Okay, so let me go to the slide. So maybe let's start with second slide, which brings some motivation why I use picture of liquid crystals. So there are many experiments in recent years for liquid crystals also getting long-range interactions like Coulomb-like. So here are some articles you can download. I have put the slides on the chat so you can get the links here. So for example, so here you can see these topological charges. So here is -1 topological charge and +1 topological charge. And in various settings, they can get various types of long-range interactions like Coulomb or even stronger, dipole-dipole, quadrupole-quadrupole. That means that looking at the positions of the two topological charges, like here, and at time, turns out that there is acceleration between them for attraction. So they have this additional acceleration, which fitting some various type of polynomial behavior, they can, for example, they can see that it's Coulomb-like interaction and so on. So they recreate this kind of long-range interaction for such topological charges with these liquid crystals. And so it brings question how far this similarity of particle physics can be taken of liquid crystals. So here is this Manfred's hedgehog as electric charge, as electron. And now we say that the second and third axis are distinguishable, so getting three types of hedgehog, which we can interpret as three leptons. So there is this big question how to get from this one charge to three leptons. But the main motivation is as in Manfred's model, So we would like to repair electromagnetism because electromagnetism has two fundamental issues. One issue is that it lacks the Gauss law. So in standard Maxwell equation with Gauss law, we can get any real charge. But in nature, there are only integer charges. So the question is how to repair Gauss law to make it calculate integer only charges. So the idea, Matthew's idea is to make it calculate the topological charge. So we look at this. So to calculate this topological charge, we need to integrate over some closed surface of the Jacobian of the function from this surface to our sphere, and this Jacobian becomes the curvature. So comparing this formula with Gauss law, we see that we should interpret this curvature as electric field. So this is Manfred's idea. So to repair the Gauss law to have built-in charge quantization, we interpret a curvature of the field. So we interpret the curvature of the field as electric field. This way, Gauss law counts topological charts, so we have built-in charge quantization. Another problem of Maxwell equations is that there is infinite energy of electric field of a point charge. So integrating an energy density of electric field from zero, we get infinite energy. So this is a big problem. So we need some deformation to repair it. So we need to deform electric field very close to this point, this electron, not to exceed the mass of electron with this energy, with integral of this energy density. So the idea we are using is using this Higgs-like potential. So for example, here we have a hedgehog as a topological charge of this vector, but if this hedgehog would continue to the center, then we would have discontinuity in the center. Yeah, so we would have all the direction in the center. So it would have infinite energy. So to repair this problem, we are using this Higgs-like potential. So we say that the field indeed prefers unitary vectors, but not to get to infinite energy, it can deform in the center of such singularity. So here we can see that there is activated this Higgs potential presented with grayness, which prevents the infinity energy of this singularity. So this is for vector field, and I would like to take it for this liquid crystal like system, which are quite physical and resemble particle physics. I try to convince you. So we would like again, so to represent this kind of field of liquid crystals, we usually use some field M of real symmetric matrices, which eigenvectors represent the axes, the two directions, and eigenvalues are preferred by some potential. So the potential is like Higgs-like, but for example, somehow preferring some set of eigenvalues, which define the shape of ellipsoid, our molecule in liquid crystal language. Okay, so this way we can get to this charge quantization. Having charge quantization, such simplest non-trivial charge becomes model of electron. And now there is this big question, how to get further particles. And we know that we have three leptons, so the same charge, but different mass. So as I have mentioned, that we can get it this way. Additionally, they have also magnetic dipole moment. So they act as a real tiny magnet. So here, to get this tiny magnet, you can see that there is a conflict. So making this hedgehog, we have this conflict. It's called in Hayley-Ball theorem that we cannot align continuously unitary vector field on a sphere. So we get additional conflict here. So this conflict means that there is additional defect also of magnetic type here. So due to this conflict, I'm saying that there are no naked charges, only charges with built-in magnetic dipole moment. So this is very non-trivial property of physics. We argue with Manfred if it should be a constant magnet or maybe some response to some external situation or movement. Okay, so this way we get both the three leptons and the built-in magnetic dipole moment as fixed magnet. So additionally we get this dynamics of twist of this axis, which were missing in the Manfred model. So I'm saying that for vacuum dynamics, so vacuum as far from particles, we have electromagnetism as the highest energetic dynamics, long range dynamics, plus this quantum phase as this twist of this axis, and it is governed by second set of some wave equations. So here we have a wave equation, Maxwell equation for electromagnetism. For quantum phase, relativistic is Klein-Gordon or Dirac maybe, and finally we have also third vacuum dynamics, general relativity. But it has also nice approximation, which is called gravity electromagnetism. So it is just second set of Maxwell equations with mass instead of charge, and getting these corrections from magnetic field corrections from the rotation of an object. So this way we can get the kind of unification of these three types of vacuum dynamics. So to get the gravity we go from three distinguished axes in space into four distinguished axes in spacetime. So we are adding the four direction, And we are saying that it has the strongest tendency to align in one direction, and its tiny perturbation gets second set of Maxwell equations for this gravity electromagnetism. So this simple picture also gives unification of these three types of vacuum dynamics of very different energy scales. So finally, the Hamiltonian, Hewlett Hamiltonian of standard electromagnetics. So this anti-symmetrized derivative of this four potential to get to Manfield's model to have built-in charge quantization as topological charge. We replace it with curvature as here. And in my view, we get nearly the same as the original one, but this time the A is this form, is this anti-symmetrized derivative. So it is corresponds to this four potential. So this time A is 3x3 anti-symmetric matrices. But we get kind of extended electromagnetism to have built in quantum phase evolution as some Klein-Gödel equation, and also gravity if you go into four-dimensional field. Okay, so this demo I have used is under this link if somebody would like. Okay, so we have these experiments. So now some would ask, what about quantum mechanics? So there are for these topological defects in superconductors or superfluids, there are called fluxons. There are observed interference, for example, the tunneling Haranoff bomb. So they behave like quantum particles. Also, there are many these hydrodynamical analogs of quantum phenomena. So they are created that we have some surface of fluid which is vibrating, and then there is a droplet which is bouncing from this surface. So this way it creates some coupled wave, and through interaction with this wave that they get interference in double slit experiments. So using many droplets, they get interference pattern in statistics of these droplets. Here is the statistics. They have tunneling. The behavior depends on this very complex field situation. Then there is orbit quantization. So here is this such orbit quantization that this droplet makes some periodic orbit, and not all orbits are allowed, but only some discrete space of possible orbits. So it is quantized, and the quantization condition is that this coupled wave, this coupled pilot wave, has to become a standing wave. So it becomes stationary Schrödinger equation kind of for this coupled wave, for the understanding why we have atoms with quantized energy states. So there are, I really recommend these kind of experiments which create many quantum phenomena. Okay, so what are these topological defects? So in two dimensions, we have this kind of so it means that to calculate this topological charge, we take a loop around a closed loop and look how many times the filter rotates around this loop. So here it rotates one. So there is plus one topological charge here also once. So still plus one, here is minus one. So the field rotates in the opposite direction. Here is plus two. So the field rotates twice if you're going around. But we can also have one half as for spin. So how to get one half? So usually there is used some magic with some 720 degrees, but we don't need it. So to get one half spin this way, topological charge, we only need to say that this value of field and this value of field is the same. So this way, rotating around, our field performs only half rotation, but we say that this field and this field is the same, so half rotation already goes back to the original field. So we can get this one half topological charge, which corresponds to spin. So there are many suggestions to interpret this kind of two-dimensional topological charge as spin. Also, looking at quantum rotation operator, it says that spin S particle is such that if it's rotating by theta angle, the phase rotates by theta times spin. What is exactly what's happening here? Also, if B spinor, you have the same. Also in Fluxon, I see some. Also in Fluxon, in Fluxon we see that we have quantization of magnetic field in superconductor exactly because of this kind of mechanism. So I interpret this two-dimensional topological charge as spin, and for three-dimensional we use this kind of. So like Hitchcock in two dimensions also. So there is a difference. So electric charge is this kind of topological charge for me, and spin is this kind of topological charge. So it also the spin is connected to magnetic field as in Fluxon. So here is a picture where this long range interaction comes from. So here you have the plus topological charge and minus topological charge in various distances. So what we can see that integrating the energy density of the field, what is the tension? So the tension here is much larger than the tension here. So to minimize energy, the field would like to take the two charges, the opposite charges together. So this way we can get a long range interaction like Coulomb, for example, in two dimensions. Also, we have this freedom for Gauss. So having these two charges, so here is plus, there is still freedom. We could rotate the field everywhere, and it is topologically the same situation. So we get this freedom for this evolution of phase I have shown. So having some situation, we can have still this evolution of phase. Yeah, so we have this Gauss invariance. So let's go further. So let me talk about this unification of electromagnetism and quantum phase into one object. So this unification is suggested, for example, in the momentum operator. So momentum operator, we have some derivative, Nabla gradient, and A. So the question is, could we take both into one object such that this is some derivative of this object? And this is what I'm doing. So I'm saying that we have two type of phases. So we need one phase for quantum phase for this pilot wave. So it is like this S1 type of phase required for interference, Mach Zehnder interference, and many other situations. So some pilot wave, but also we need additional phase for this charge quantization to make that Gauss law count some topological charge of this phase for electromagnetism. So we need here S2 type of phase for charge quantization and S1 kind of phase for quantum phase. And you can unify both into one SO3. So here is this picture. So here you have the molecule or something, and the rotation of the long axis corresponds to high energy vacuum degree of freedom of electromagnetism, and twist correspond to quantum phase, so low energy vacuum degree of freedom for pilot wave. We get this unification, and we can see this A is also a derivative. What is, for example, seen in this quantization of magnetic field through in Fluxon, that A also corresponds to some rotation of some field. So I use this M as this real symmetric matrix with fixed eigenvalues as shape of the ellipsoid, and here I define this mu as this commutation of m and derivative of m, and it acts as local rotation, so like connection in Matthews model, but with added weighted of the shape of the object. So rotation, this rotation is low energetic, and this rotation is high energetic. So we get unification of electromagnetism and quantum phase. So for electromagnetics we get wave equation as Maxwell equation, and for quantum phase we have Klein-Gordon. Now you'd like to have one phase for which, looking at these two aspects, we get both. And going to four-dimensional object, we get additional second set of Maxwell equation for gravity. Okay, so let me compare with standard Skrymian model, which are getting popularity. For example, here are models of nuclei using the standard Skrymian models. So they use quite similar kinetic terms. So there is also some some connection, and we define with the connection some kinetic energy. So how the field don't like the tension, but we have also a potential. So the different here is the main difference. So they use potential with single minimum. So far from particle. So when there is no longer need to make some deformation with the Higgs potential I've mentioned. So far from particles, that the field needs to go to this single minimum. So this way they cannot have long range interaction. They have only short range exponentially weakening interactions. So we have no electromagnetism. So for them, proton and neutron is the same. So the question is how to repair it. So the difference with models we are using, also liquid crystal people, is that we are using potential, which is Higgs-like potential. So no longer single minimum, but minimum sphere or SO3 I'm using. So we have potential with this minimum. So and this means that we have these Goldstone bosons, zero massless Goldstone bosons, which corresponds to electromagnetism and this quantum phase evolution here. So and I will show that in this model proton is no longer the same as neutron, but there is nice intuition why proton should be lighter than neutron as in physics. Okay, so here are some my suggestion how to speculation how to get the further particles. Yes, so here is the hedgehog like in Manfield's model, and here we can say that the three axes are different. So we have three types of hedgehog, the same topological charge but different mass. So they are similar to leptons. And the liquid crystal people said that they should realize them experimentally. So then we can have this kind of vortices like fluxons. So something what has in the cross section this kind of configuration. So this two-dimensional defect in cross section, and they form, for example, loop. So this loop is much lighter because it needs weaker deformation than this point like this the center of the chair. So it is much lighter and very stable. So it's very difficult to interact with this kind of loop. And additionally, we get three types of them because it can be looped around along one or the second or the third axis. So we have three types of this kind of loops. So and we could kind of oscillate between them. So we can rotate the field from one to another configuration. So they kind of resemble the three neutrinos. So very light, very difficult to interact with. And can rotate or oscillate one to another. But the most interesting are baryons, I believe in this view. So baryons is the simplest knot. So we have one vortex, this fluxon in the center, and another fluxon around. So we got this kind of simplest loop. So here is a cross section. So here we have this vortex in the center and the vortex around. So what we can see that there is some interaction between these two vertices. So this vortex around bends the field inside, bends the axis inside, the black line. And this bending, if this bending would close, it would form a hedgehog. So this interaction between this external vortex and internal vortex enforces some electric charge. So proton can just enclose this electric charge into plus E. But neutron cannot. Neutron has to compensate it. So neutron has this enforced, let's say, plus 2/3 as for quark interpretation, and it needs to compensate it to zero. So we have minus one third, and it is a larger configuration. So it is wider configurations, what costs more energy. So this way we get intuition why proton is lighter than neutron. Because in this picture, all baryons required electric charge, some not necessarily entire charge. In proton, we can just enclose this charge. In neutron, we have to compensate it to zero. Also, we get deuteron binding this way. So in deuteron, we have two baryons with one charge. So we have, let's say, 2/3 enforced, 2/3 enforced, and 1/3 in the center. Okay, so maybe let's look at these two examples. I think they are very promising. So why is proton lighter than neutron is very, very surprising, because naively you would say that proton has charge and charge costs energy. So naively we should have the opposite. So this is nice intuition. Why so? Because baryons require charge, and proton just closes this charge. Neutron has to compensate this charge. And deuteron can neutron will share the charge between two baryons, and it gives the binding energy. So they want to have shared both need the discharge, and now they can share one, so we can have lower energies as binding energy of this nucleus. So does it agree with some experimental predictions? Yes. So there are a few papers claiming that charge distribution in neutron is this kind. So claiming that in neutron you have positive core and negative shell. There are these three papers you can take a look at. So we assume that neutrons are built of these quarks. So there should be some charge distribution inside, and this is suggested distribution, and also agreeing with predicted by the model I'm talking about. For the deuteron, it's very non-trivial that it has large electric quadrupole moment. So naively, it's proton and neutron. So naively, it shouldn't have electric quadrupole moment. But here we see that they should have. We have plus, minus, plus. And it turns out experimentally, it indeed has. So this PN has large electric quadrupole moments, what is quite surprising. And this model suggests why it's so. Because baryons require some charge. And these two pluses here required for quadrupole moment are the two baryons. So very simple model and gives nice, at least intuitive understanding of basic nuclear physics properties. Okay, so also we can have, for example, this twist. The loop around can be twisted internally, and it nicely agrees with strangeness, for example. So we have some strange baryon, and it releases part of its twist as pion and goes to this lower strangeness baryon. Also, for larger particles, we can have knots of these vortices of larger sizes to bind them into larger knots as larger nuclei. And also, there are these haloneutrons. So there are very, very strange objects. So for example, lithium 11 has two neutrons in very large distance, like 5 femtometers. So the question is how to bind neutrons in very large distance, larger than nuclear force distance. And this is a suggestion that maybe is this kind of fluxion vortex binding them in stable way for milliseconds even. So there are surprising haloneutrons, which also are suggested in this model. Okay, so but finally we need these fluxons in vacuum. So the question is, if do we have fluxons in vacuum, not only in a superconductor but also in vacuum? And I think that the strongest suggestion beside this haloneutron are the magnetic flux tubes. So looking at sun's corona, turns out that there are nearly one-dimensional magnetic structures observed shining. And it is not well understood why they are stable. So here is a book about them, and it also suggests that maybe they have similar nature as these fluxons in superconductor.
There will be a talk of Ilan Roth.
Yes.
Ilan, so this will be after this session, so please pay attention to it. Thank you.
Yes. Yeah, so there are not well understood why there are so stable, and maybe some topological mechanisms like in fluxon in superconductor would be helpful here. And my model also requires this kind of topological one-dimensional structures. Okay, so let's go to some mathematics. So first to go to the Mantis model. So we have some field of unitary vectors, usually with Heath-like potential, so to prevent the infinity in the center. So it can deform in the center, but usually in vacuum it's unitary vector field. So we can use this have this affine connection gamma, which says that going in I direction, our vector field rotates around some axis with some speed. So gamma connection describes local rotation of our vector field. So if it rotates this way, then the vector field rotation is here, and the length of this vector defines the speed of rotation. So for example, around this hedgehog in two dimension, the gamma behaves one over r drops with distance. Yeah? So going here, the rotation slows down because of this distance. Then we have curvature as a cross product of some such two gammas. So around a hedgehog in three dimension now, we have gamma in one direction, gamma in second direction, and you take cross product getting some r which it goes outside the curvature, the hedgehog, and it drops with strength with now second power, r to minus two, because we have product of two gammas. So it drops as electric field, yes? So, and also we can show that integrating it over a closed surface, we get topological charge. So using it for interpreting it as electric field and using Gauss law, now our electromagnetism, Gauss law counts topological charge, so we get built in charge quantization. So this is the idea to interpret this curvature as electric charge. And so this is spatial curvature. So we have two spatial directions, but we can also have temporal direction. So it, one is in time and one is in space. So finally, we get this 4x4 anti-symmetric tensor. So the spatial part is the electric field. The time space parts, there are resemblances with magnetic fields as Pantheon has talked about. So it is very similar to this F-mini tensor in electromagnetism, but we've switched electric and magnetic field. So this is dual electromagnetism. So there is this duality. Mathematically, they are very similar. So thanks of that, instead of Dirac monopole, we get magnetic monopole, we get only monopole of electric charge. So thanks to this duality, we change from magnetic monopole of Dirac, for example, to electric monopole. That means charge for electron, for example. So now defining this curvature and multiply it by some constant to get the agreement with physics, defining it as F-mini star as dual tensor and using standard electromagnetics, standard Lagrangian. You can recreate electromagnetism as Manfred has talked about. So this is a simple view on this model. And now there are these counter arguments that electron is perfect point, that there is no part of, so definitely there is no part of structure. There is only field deformation, not to exceed the mass of electron. So I have mentioned that energy of electric field of point charge would be infinity. Not to exceed 511 keV mass of electron, we need to integrate not from zero but from, let's say, 1.4 femtometers. Then we get approximately this mass of electron. So we need a deformation, as Malte has mentioned, in distance, a few femtometer distance, not to exceed mass of electron with electric field alone. So the question is if experimentally such deformation is observed, and there is Manfred's suggestion that yes, it is observed in so-called running coupling effect. That means that in very, very high energy collisions, the alpha defining Coulomb interaction is deformed. So the Coulomb interaction is the form of very, very high energies. That means very low distances. So here is simulation from Manfred's student. So they took this electron, so let's say plus charge, minus charge configuration, calculate the energy of this configuration, so integrate the energy density over this configuration, and look at such energy depending on the distance. So they put them in various distances. And here is the energy. So the solid line is the Coulomb interaction, perfect. But here the numerical values they get is the dashed line. So it is a bit deformed. So Coulomb interaction for very low distances is a bit deformed, and this is observed as running coupling experiments. So there are this is longer discussion, but there are nice arguments that this is not part of structure. So we don't propose any smaller particles inside the electron, only a deformation not to exceed 511 keV mass of electron, and this kind of deformation can be seen as what they get in running coupling interpretation. Okay, so electron is more than just electric charge. Yes, so we have discussed the electric charge, but it has also magnetic dipole moment. So the question is, if it's static, magnetic dipole, dynamical, I believe it's static. Why? So it has also this angular momentum, what means that it acts as a gyroscope. That here is the spin axis. If we push in this direction, the system responds in this direction. So this is having angular momentum as a gyroscope. So for example, it is seen in this Larmor precession. So in external magnetic field, we get frequency depending on this external strength of this external magnetic field. Also much more complicated situation like the spinnaker, that they have these spins of also of electrons. And then they can rotate them, then pepper from this rotation another and go back. So they can perform very complicated acrobatics on these spins of nuclei and electrons also. So there is also this clock. It's adjusted by Louis de Broglie. So we can see that in Schrödinger equation, if putting as the energy mc square, then we get some frequency, which is approximately 10^21 hertz. So it's extremely fast clock. It is also suggested, known as Titterbewegung, especially in relativistic quantum mechanics, like Dirac equation. And they observe it in a simulation of Dirac equation. And there is also a direct observation. So I think this is the nicest direct observation in this paper, which is here. So here is the plot for this direct observation. So they take high energy electrons, 81 MeV electrons. This way, due to this time dilation, the ticks, distance between the ticks of the clock become quite small, quite large. So that means here it agrees with lattice constant of some silicon crystal. So if they get agreement between the ticks of the clock with this lattice of crystal, regular lattice, then they get increased absorption. So here they get agreement and here the opposite. So we get some resonance between this clock and the lattice regular lattice of crystal. Okay, so there is this clock. So I get something like that also. So let me go to my model. So we had Manfred, so the question is how to extend this Manfred model of just vectors into three-dimensional objects which are rotated. So first I'm starting with field of rotation matrices. So in every point we have orthogonal matrix 3x3 or 4x4, and we would like to look at this kind of field of rotations. So we can again for field of rotation we can define the connection analogy to Manfred, and using this definition of connection, we get some vector inside. We get anti-symmetric matrix, and we can denote this vector as the spatial rotation, and we get also second vector, which corresponds to this rotation of this fourth axis, this time directed axis. So we would get electromagnetics for this rotation, and also additionally gravity electromagnetics for gravity for the second rotation. So we get one curvature, spatial curvature. We get also curvature is gravitational. So we would like to interpret it as a gravitational field, and we have also interaction between them. So this kind of interaction is, for example, in binding light trajectory by sun. So we get electromagnetic gravity interaction if we bend the photon trajectories by sun. So we get this kind of interactions here. But finally we need to go to some objects. So not only the field of orthogonal matrices, but field of this M field I have mentioned. So this is field of it depends on the position. So this field. So there is some D being diagonal matrix defining shape of this ellipsoid. So there are these three axes. I call them lambda one, lambda two, lambda three, the length, the size of these the three axes, and they are rotated. So this is field of some object being rotated, object defined with shape by the D, by the three lambdas here. So we need to postulate the curvature, the something what we correspond to the curvature used by Manfred. So we use this commutator of the derivatives. Doing so, we get after rotation back. So we get this form. So we get the curvature as in Manfred model, the R mini. So this is exactly as Manfred model. But now they are weighted, so now it's divided by this shape of so we can imagine that lambda one is much larger, so this is the longest axis, the lambda one, and lambda two are the third and second axis, lambda two and lambda three, and we can imagine that they are much shorter and similar. So this way, this denominator is large, lambda one minus lambda two and lambda three minus one lambda one. There are much larger, so this is small contribution. So this kind of rotation is lower energetic, and this is high energetic because lambda two and lambda three are very very similar. So we get two types of vacuum dynamics. One is corresponds to quantum phase, and the second corresponds to electromagnetic, and they have different energy scales. Okay, so now let's look that it indeed is a special that Manfred's model can be seen as a special case of this model. So let's look this kind of M. So this M has eigenvalues 1, 0, 0. So using this kind of field with n being this unitary vectors as in Manfred's model, our AMU becomes have this form. So this is as the affine connection used in Manfred's model, and going to F mini as defined previously, we get again curvature. So we can see indeed that going to that going to this limit, that the second and third axis are equal, we go back to Manfred's model. And now we would like to make this perturbation that they become distinguishable. So we can see this model as a small perturbation of Manfred's model, perturbation to add this quantum phase, low energetic quantum phase dynamics with Kain-Gordon-like equation. Okay, so now we can go to Maxwell equations. So having this Lagrangian in vacuum, we get trivial Maxwell equation, just the Lambertian equal zero. So like Kain-Gordon, but this time we have so the Lambertian equal zero vacuum equation. But alpha is from zero to three, so there are four equations, and also A is a matrix, so it's 3 by 3. Asymmetric matrix, so there are three inside coordinates. So in fact, there are 12 Maxwell vacuum equations here. But it contains both the electromagnetics Maxwell equation for electromagnetics as this dynamics of this long axis, and Kain-Gordon-like lower energetic wave equation for the twist as the quantum phase. So finally, let's look at some ansatz. So we would like to get this Hedgehog ansatz as a Manfred model now, but the problem is that we now have this additional phase. So now we have to remember also about the phase. So we perform the Hedgehog with the longest axis and use the psi function, psi here, as additional function which defines the phase. So the question is how to do it in the details. There are a few ways. But using this equation, so here we can see that we have this A as written previously, so m times derivative, m derivative minus m. So this is this anti-commutator as written previously, and now we look at these Maxwell equations, these now 12 equations for in vacuum, and looking at that, this additional phase which was missing in Manfred's model gets Klein-Gordon-like equation. So we get second time derivative equals Laplacian, and this Laplacian is modified with this function with first derivative divided by R. So looking at Klein-Gordon equation with in point charge potential, we get this one over R and first derivative term. So we recreate part of the Klein-Gordon equation. There are missing the mass term. I think for the mass term, I need to go to 4x4 matrices, no 3x3. Also, I don't know how to get this form, this term. But we recreate part of Klein-Gordon equation for the additional quantum phase, this extension of Manfield's model. Okay, so let me finish. So this is last slide, a summary. So on the right we can see a Lagrangian of standard model from the link here. So it has 26 parameters. There are problems with gravity. So the question is maybe this huge formula can be simplified. For example, be seen as some Taylor expansion of a simpler model. So the question is where to search for this kind of simpler model. So maybe in liquid crystals. Liquid crystals are observed in nature. So it's not some 20-dimensional splitting theory, but really is really physical object. And this very simple Hamiltonian, which is just extended electromagnetic Hamiltonian to contain also this quantum phase, gravity electromagnetism, seems to recreate quite a lot. So vacuum dynamics is very similar as in real physics. We get three leptons with Coulomb interaction, charge quantization, with magnetic dipole moments, neutrinos, baryons with neutron heavier than proton, with deuteron binding, and maybe other further nuclei of halo nuclei, some strangeness, Dekatu mesons. So this is a long, difficult road, but maybe if looking at quantum field theory for this kind of model. So in quantum field theory, we can see that we have Feynman ensemble of scenarios. So we have some particle decay, some collisions, and also for solitons, we can again considering some scattering with incomplete knowledge. We need to perform some ensemble of possible scenarios. And doing it right, hopefully we can get the something close to some standard model. So that's the long road, but I think it's quite promising direction that so simple model, which is just extended electromagnetism, gives as much in the real physics. Okay, thank you very much, and I'm glad you discuss. Is Matthew?
So thank you very much for this presentation. Have you any questions?
Okay.
How do you see the difference between strong and weak interaction? If you take, for example, nuclear force,
sure.
Explain with transfer of pions.
So this is a very difficult question. How to interpret various types of particles in physics? So like virtual particles. Like this interactive bosons. So personally, I would like to imagine that this shape, this deformation as weak interaction and interaction between the vortices as strong interaction. So this regularization to weak interaction and interaction between the vortices like inside the baryons are strong interaction. So that's my view, but to get it into some perturbative QFTs is a long road. Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
May I? Sure.
Professor Danielewski?
You use simple expression. Crystal topological defects. This suggests that there is analogy between defects. Could you say and show analogy between, for example, defects, planar defects in solids, etc.?
So the analogy between particle physics. So here is the overview of this analogy. So So topological charge as electron and then three leptons.
No, but analogy.
So analogy is, for example, that we have Coulomb interaction. So looking at pairs of such topological charges, we get the Coulomb interaction between them, for example.
But then there is problem with liquid means in most cases a loss of, for example, from turbulence and gravity is not protection.
So yes, yeah, so it should be a superfluid liquid crystal. Yes. So in fact, there is no viscosity in real physics.
Why not solid?
It doesn't matter. So I only need this. So liquid crystal is nice because they have this kind of molecules. So molecules of shape of rod-like molecules or this biaxial pneumatic with three different axes. So already observed in physics fields with three different axes, what I topologically require to get the three leptons, for example. If one axis I can get electron, but to get the three leptons, the question is, so we are arguing with Manfred how to get the three leptons. So I would need the three axes also to get the quantum phase, then as this rotation, as vacuum dynamics.
I have a question.
Sure.
Can I?
Sure.
Hello?
Yes.
Fine. I have a question. Jarek, you have showed, among others, as I have understood, a new definition of the tensor F. Yes? In order to... please show it again, and I would like to...
So this is Manfred definition. This is a dual definition. So we exchange B and E.
You have defined the tensor F by, of course, in any handbook or paper, standard definition of tensor F is done by using the gauge potential A. Yes.
So Manfred usually goes directly from N to curvature, but in the middle we have this gamma, and the gamma works as A. So what I'm doing is first defining A as this kind of m times mu minus mu times m, and I interpret it as four potential. It works as four potential, and then using this kind of definition, I get f mini exactly as okay. So for example, here it is nicely presented. So okay, so this formula at the bottom, so. So standard electromagnetism, we have Hamiltonian this, yes, with a for potential. In Manfred model, we get this curvature, and I'm going back to this original definition with a different definition of A. So instead of being for vector, additionally it's made of matrices. So A mu is T/3 anti-symmetric matrix. But we got the same formulation as standard electromagnetism. So this is generalized extended electromagnetism this way. Generalized extended to quantum phase evolution and to gravity in four dimensions.
So thank you. I think it needs a lot of discussion, obviously, but we need some break now. So now 8 minutes break. Thank you very much. Thank you.